Beginning with the time Jesus' entry to Jerusalem, we're entering into this week called the Holy Week, the holiest week of Christian year. Walking with God closer towards the cross each day. And today's scripture passage is where it gets the most intense, the very last few events leading up to Jesus' death. Without a doubt, this is namely the climax of our Lenten journey, which means it is the deepest moment of our self-reflection and the darkest day of Christian story. And as much the church rhythm, this liturgical calendar rhythm, tells me to be prepared for this challenging week, this little voice in me was saying to me, but I don't want to. Especially at this time when we're on the other end of the Vermont winter. You know, we had a long enough winter. We had our share of darkness. We had our share of cringing in our blankets. Now, when we're finally seeing some signs of warmth and sunshine, the smell of dirt and colors of life blossoming out from it, feeling the great, lively energy in downtown of Montpelier, I honestly don't feel like going into a Holy Week mood. There's that voice of hesitation. In fact, this hesitation may be part of our nature. That hesitation to not wanting to sing Amazing Grace at the funeral because it's too depressing. That hesitation that we have when we hear the requirements for discipleship, when Jesus says, you must deny yourselves and take up your cross daily and follow me. I don't know, Jesus. Yes, I understand that our human nature needs your salvation. Yes, we understand that the kingdom of God you taught us about will require us to some sacrifices here and there of our own desires. Yes, we understand that we will need some patience. We understand all of that. But I don't know if I'm down for this crucifixion, right? I don't feel like going into Holy Week. There's got to be a better way. I'm sure there's a way that will minimize the emotions around the cross and still get your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. There's got to be a better way, easier way that will be much quicker, more victorious and crystal clear. And I'm not trying to say that we aren't doing enough or we aren't meeting God's expectations as disciples. And even if we are, that's not what my point is today. My point is that this exact hesitation may be what the world around Jesus' time was experiencing. From today's reading, we heard about the religious leaders and the rulers of the people bringing Jesus to Pilate. Pilate really didn't see any clear reason for a death penalty, right? He said, I have examined him in your presence and have found no basis for your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to me. As you can see, he has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and then release him. That's in verses 14 and 16. That was the initial rule of the court. But in response to this decision by Pilate, we see that the whole crowd has this surprising, somewhat surprising, hostile reaction as a bunch. They were saying, the whole crowd was shouting, "Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us! Crucify him! Crucify him!" It's a little confusing how they reacted, because until just before this scene, the so-called crowd around Jesus was a very supportive one in nature. Many times we see people coming out and following him from everywhere he went, and to hear what he had to say, being amazed by his teachings and the power of his healing. They were amazed. Especially from the portion we read in the beginning of the service out in the narthex, which was the scene when Jesus was entering Jerusalem on the colt. Luke's version of the Palm Sunday story doesn't mention about the children and all the palms and stuff, but neither describes the crowd as the insignificant general public. But it says, when he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. So it's a little confusing to me how this type of crowd of disciples turned into the crowd who's shouting for Barabbas. Are they two different, divided groups of people on the issue of Jesus? Then where are those from the crowd of disciples who would stand with Jesus? Or are they the same crowd who has changed their stance during the period of less than a week? I'm sure there must have been those small percentage at the extreme ends of the spectrum. It's not much different from how our world goes during these years. These are the ones who has made up their mind clearly on the opposite ends. But there are those who are in the middle. So it's in the middle, a larger percentage of people. And these are the ones who are hesitating. Among many crowd behavior theories, there is a theory by Sigmund Freud. And he argues that becoming a member of a crowd serves to unlock the unconscious mind. Becoming a member of a crowd serves to unlock the unconscious mind. This happens because the superego, or in other words, the moral center of consciousness, is displaced by the larger crowd to be replaced by a charismatic crowd leader. And 20th century psychologist William McDougall argues similarly with Freud, that he says, simplistic emotions are widespread and complex emotions are rarer. In a crowd, the overall shared emotional experience reverts to the least common denominator, leading to primitive levels of emotional expression. Primitive levels of emotional expression. And from the crowd being led into those primitive emotional expressions, demanding Pilate for the crucifixion of Jesus, we may see a deep hesitation that is in all of us. Jesus has been demonstrating what the kingdom of God looks like throughout the entire gospel. And we still have a hard time understanding what that is. Is it a mustard seed? Is it a pearl? Or is it the yeast working its way through a dough? At the heart of this hesitation, there is our struggle to recognize Jesus as the King. We're looking at the cross and we wonder, this can't be it. Can it? Can this be what the Messiah, the long-awaited one, intending to do with his reign? This can't be it. While we're standing under the cross trying to process with our brains all the things that just happened, still hesitating to walk the walk of the cross, still hesitating to go into the holiest week of our spiritual reflection, refusing and denying to go to the funeral of Jesus, first because we know what the emotion is like. So we'd rather just jump to Easter morning when everything will be happy. Still hesitating between the crowd of the Palm Sunday march and the crowd at the Pilate's court. While we're trying to make up our minds, perhaps we see we are actually more like Barabbas. Barabbas. Barabbas, who was not a common criminal. He was part of a rebellion, according to the Gospel of Luke, and it was a violent one. He was charged with murder also. It doesn't say if he saw himself or his followers saw him as a possible king of the Jews to be in direct comparison with Jesus, but that is unlikely. But it came down to a choice. That's the reality. It came down to a choice. One of them is to die. And it turns out to be Jesus. The choice was between either the one who stands for violent revolution, which Jesus has opposed from the beginning, or the one who has been all about the way of peace, the violence and the peace. At the end, Jesus died in place of the violent rebel. And this is the gospel. We, as sinners, as a human race, are all invited to see ourselves in Barabbas. We discover in this story that Jesus comes to take our place. Even when the so-called justice of every human system justified the killing of Jesus, God's mercy is so much larger than the human mercy. So as we are hesitant to begin this Holy Week, hesitant to enter into Jerusalem with Jesus towards the cross, let us remember Barabbas, that there is a part for each of us. No matter how it may seem, it may play a very important role as the gospel story goes forward. You know, I doubt that Barabbas knew at that time his name was going to be spoken by people until after more than 2,000 years afterwards. So the question is, are you standing at the gateway of Jerusalem? Are you hesitating? If you are, I pray that through this Holy Week experience, you will be filled with such amazing grace of God, and that it will allow us to dream and hope when we follow this Jesus and carry his cross as ours, that we will be part of God's larger work. And I believe that by this grace, if you're hesitating, it will turn into a place of joy and excitement from our place of hesitation. As we sing, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Amen.